Hi everyone, so today we'll continue our lectures with elementary programming and we'll do a coding towards the end of the class of the labs today. One thing that I want to remind everyone is that the lectures are recorded and they are posted on with links on Piazza. There is also the playlist for all of the lectures on YouTube, which becomes is at the beginning of the recordings. So the lectures are recorded and posted on YouTube. The labs are recorded and just left on Zoom. And you can basically see the labs interleaved with the lectures. Also in the TA office hours, I actually created a Google Calendar in which I put all of the TA's office hours from Monday to Friday, and also the class and the lab that follows the class. So you can basically, depending on the day and the time of the day, you can find who's the next TA that is available. So let's return back to the lecture. Feel free to stop me at any moment if you have any questions, okay? You can either post them in the chat or even better, you can unmute yourself and just ask the question. So we'll start with variables. Basically, variables store data. It's the same with mathematics. When you have an equation, x plus y is equal to 5, x and y are basically, they store some data, but you basically have to find what's the value of x and what's the value of that variable y. The same notion of variables we have in computer programming. There are two types of variables in Java. I mentioned this at the end of last class. There are primitive type variables, which store single pieces of data. Basically, the variable is an alias for a location in memory that will basically store that data. And if you remember at the end of last class, I basically showed you that I, for instance, in this case, is an alias for a location in memory that has one assigned to it. Similarly, the letter is a variable of the type character char in Java. And it stores the character, the Unicode of the character uppercase A. The other type of variables in Java are called object or reference types. The idea of this type of variables is that you have a class which has multiple properties. Now, the variable itself doesn't actually contain the data. It has a reference or an address of a location in memory that actually contains an object of that specific type of class. Like for instance, string, and it basically contains that string. So just to remind everyone this, I was showing you this last class. When you have like an int I is equal with one, I is just an alias for a location in memory that actually stores that value. So it's an address in this case. It's actually a location in this case of 4 bytes, which is the size of an integer. And that location will just contain that value, the value that is assigned to it. And that's different for strings or arrays or any other type that is a reference type. It's not one of the 8 primitive types. So when you have a string s is equal with I, basically, S contains an address. So you can think of it as basically an address to an actual object somewhere in the rest of memory. In this case is in the global segment of memory that contains an object of the type string. And that object actually contains, so this is some string. And that object actually contains the actual string, in this case, hi. Okay, so this is the difference between reference types, like the string variable below, and primitive types like int, that actually the variable stores the value. Okay. Now, all variables in Java must have a declared type. So there are different programming languages, Python, which has dynamic typing, and also it basically It's a dynamic strong typing. It infers the type of the variable, and actually every single operation has to have exact types. So for instance, if you concatenate a string with a number, that will not work unless you transform first the number to a string. Java is a statically typed language, also a little bit weakly typed than Python. So in Java, operations that can be resolved, although they are not exactly those strict operation that was required, will succeed by doing basically some intuitive result. So in the case of concatenating a string with a number, in Java, it will transform internally the number implicitly into a string, and then it does concatenation. However, as I said, Java is statically typed. You have to declare the type of the variable before you can assign anything to that variable. And the type determines multiple things. It determines what kind of value the variable holds, like for instance, for an int. It can only store numbers that can be represented on 32 bits. So it basically knows how much memory to reserve to that variable. Another thing that the variable determines is what kind of operations this variable can be included in. So for instance, if you have a Boolean variable, you cannot use it in Java for some arithmetic expression, because Boolean values, true and false, do not have a number value in Java. In other programming languages, there are conventions that true means any value different than zero, usually one, and false means zero. Okay. So first thing that we need to say about Java is that it's statically typed, meaning that when you declare a variable, you have to specify its type. And here, these are examples of declaring variables in Java. Char, letter. Letter in this case is a variable of the type character. Int I. I is an integer. Double area. So area will be a location in memory that has 8 bytes, 64 bits length, and can store real numbers as doubles. String S. S is a reference to a string. By default is null. So as long as we don't assign anything to it, it basically is the null reference. For the other type of variables in Java, for local variables, they don't have a value. Before you use either one of these, letter I or area, you have to initialize them. If you try to print them without being initialized, you will have a compiler error, because the Java compiler does not let you print or use in any expression a variable unless it was initialized. And then there is a super type of all types in Java called object, all reference types in Java called object. And you can actually create objects of that type. So in this case, O is a variable of the type object. And we'll learn later this semester that a variable that is of the type of a super class can hold any values of a subclass. In Java, a variable of the type object can be assigned any other object, any other reference type. So let's start with primitive types. So last time I was basically telling you that there are many different primitive types in Java, specifically 8, 4 integer or whole numbers, which are byte, short, int, and long. And the values of these basically range between -2^7 to 2^7 -1. So basically, because byte has 8 bits, it can represent 2^8 values. But those 2^8 values are split into two. -2^7 included up to 2^7 -1 included. So in this case, it's -128 up to 127. And during the lab today, you read a number, you don't know what it is, you can read it as a long, and then you have to determine if it can be stored in a byte, it can be stored in a short, an int, or a long. And basically, these are the sizes of those types. Byte is 1 byte, short is 2 bytes, int is representing a whole number on 4 bytes, so 32 bits, and long is representing a whole number on 8 bytes. 64 bits. So it basically can represent between minus 2 to the power 63 to 2 to the power 63. And those are the values for those numbers. Then we have real numbers. In Java, the encoding for real numbers is different than integers. It's actually a standard encoding called IEEE, a real number encoding, which actually uses negative powers of 2 to represent real numbers. So one thing that you should be aware of is that basically you can represent very precise real numbers, but some real numbers are actually not representable because they don't amount to a sum of 2 to the power of basically powers of 2. So for instance, 0.1 is such an example. 0.1 is not represented exactly in Java. And I will give you an example later. And that's why it's very important when you compare numbers, not to compare doubles with equality, because numbers are not precise. Equality is not precise. Zero is not 0.0, because 0.0, if you attain it out of subtracting from some number multiple values, like for instance, you subtract out of 1 10 times 0.1, you would expect the result to be 0. But the result is not 0, because 0.1, as I said, is not precise. So when you start subtracting 10 times, you will basically run into this issue that things are not equal, because they are not representing exactly the values as real numbers. I will show you an example in a couple of minutes later today. Then let's talk about characters. So char is the type that can represent characters. Java uses an encoding called UTF-16, which is also called Unicode 2, meaning that basically there is an encoding in 2 bytes of Unicode characters. Is a variable length encoding, because Unicode characters, to represent them, you actually need 4 bytes. So if the encoding of the character is less than 4 bytes, is less than actually 2 bytes representation, then they will actually be represented on 2 bytes. However, if the Unicode character is some special character that appears after the 2 bytes encoding, basically, the last bit in this 2 bytes encoding is used as continuation bit. So if that is 1, it basically means that a third byte is needed to represent the character. And similarly, if 3 bytes is not enough, you will actually have to use a fourth byte. Booleans just store 1 bit. Now, because 1 bit is not addressable, internally, it actually uses 1 bit, the least significant bit out of 1 byte to represent Boolean, true or false. Now, variables can be assigned a value. So usually you see when we declare the variable in one step, int I equal 1. That is a value of the type of that specific variable. You can also assign to them the value of an expression. So for instance, int I is equal with 3 plus 2. That's totally fine. The expression is evaluated first, and then the value of that expression after it was evaluated is assigned to the variable. A variable must also be declared before you can actually assign a value to it. So here we have 2 examples, a good example and a bad example. The good example declares the variable salary. Then in the next statement, it assigns to salary $20,000 and it prints out the salary. This will actually run perfectly in Java. It will basically assign a salary to that salary of 20,000 to that variable salary. And then it prints them. However, the next statement will actually have a compiler error in the second line. When you try to assign to salary a value, but salary was not defined yet, it's only defined the next statement, it will appear that this is a statement with an error. And in fact, it will tell you that the first statement is an error, then the next statement is an error because you try to assign to that variable 20,000, but that variable was not defined. So you can't define it later afterwards. So in Java, you must declare variables of a precise strict type before you can assign values to them. And this is different than other dynamically typed languages where the type of the variable is inferred from what do you assign to it. There are two questions in the chat. Can you define and assign a variable in one line? Yes, of course. And I will actually show you that's exactly what we have next. So you can declare and initialize at once, like the character yes car is assigned y, the string word is assigned hello, the double variable average is assigned 0.0, and the standard deviation also 0.0. So they can declare multiple variables and assign values to them into one single statement. So in that case, you have one type, multiple variables, and you don't need to assign to all of them or to any of them basically values. So you can also declare double average comma std deviation semicolon. Similarly, character initial t3 is assigned the uppercase T, and completed is assigned false. Now, we said first that before you assign a value, you initialize a variable, you need to declare it first. The second rule in Java is that you must initialize a variable before it's referenced. These are local variables in Java. So Java basically, it's fine as long as you assign a value to a variable to use that variable later. Like for instance, we assign to the salary 20,000, the raise is assigned salary multiplied with 0.05, that's a 5% raise, and then you print out the raise, the new basically salary, including, actually no, it's actually the just the raise itself, 5% out of $20,000. However, if you declare a variable in Java, like for instance salary, but you don't initialize it with any value, and then you try to compute a raise for that salary by multiplying with 0.05, you get a compiler error. Salary has no value. This only applies to local variables. So let me show you what I mean by that. So let's create a new class in Java. Let's call it test. Okay, so that example that I was showing you earlier, double salary, and now we basically define double raise is equal with salary multiplied with 0.05. Now you have an error. So this basically says that you need to initialize the variable before you use it. However, if I take this local variable and I move it as a global variable, static double salary, there is no problem anymore. So the problem is that global variables, or they are called static variables or class variables, have default values. So basically, any number is basically zero. Car will basically have the Unicode zero. Boolean will have false, and reference types are null. It's a special keyword. It's basically a null reference keyword. So that's the case for static variables, like basically class variables. They don't actually need to be static, but as long as they are class variables, dynamic data fields or static variables, they have default values. That's not the case for local variables. Local variables do not have default values. So that was the example that I was giving you, that if you define another variable salary 2, you don't initialize it, but you try to use it here, it will basically give you an error. It will tell you that there is, you must initialize the variable before you use it. This is a compiler error. Basically, there is nothing that can be done because you can't solve that compilation error. So it's not 100% correct what I said here. A variable must be initialized before reference. It's more a local variable must be initialized before reference.
Professor?
Go ahead.
Why is there this distinction that the compiler, you know, gives the value to the class variables, but not the local ones? You know, like what would be the purpose of that within the
To tell you the truth, I do not know, because I personally do not see any difference, even in the case of class variables like this one, you have an associated space for that location. And for local variables, you also declare and have an associated space. So why not initialize it with a default value? Especially that now we have a difference between these kind of variables, class variables, and local variables. So to tell you the truth, I do not know. There might be a reason, and I will look for it. And if I find it, I will let you know. But I do not know.
All right, thank you.
Welcome. I really don't know. I was thinking maybe there is a reason because you have to create those objects at, in this case, at compile time because this is static, but that's not the case either, because you can define non-static data fields like double D, and then you can have double D2 is equal with D multiplied with 2. And there is no problem here because it doesn't matter if these are static or not, they are still initialized with 0 by default. Both of them are allocated in memory. Basically, when you create the object, you allocate it in memory. When you compile the class for static variables, they are also created in memory when you start the runtime machine. So I do not know the answer. Okay. I will look for it. One other thing that maybe it's of interest, in other programming languages, like for instance in C, you actually the default value is whatever was in that memory location. So basically the default value is, so C allocates that space. And if there was some garbage, you have in that variable that garbage. So if you define some variable and you don't initialize it and later you try to use it, it will basically have whatever value was in that location at that time. So my best guess, but this is really just a guess, is that Java wants to be more correct, meaning that there are precise rules, static variables or class variables, doesn't matter if they're static or not, get those default values, and local variables are basically statically checked. They must basically, in order to eliminate errors, because the programmer didn't assign any value to that variable, you must initialize it before you use it. So I think it's basically kind of like error checking, helping the programmer to not to make errors, not to forget to initialize a variable before they use it. That's my best guess.
All right, thank you.
Welcome. Okay, good. Next. It looks like when I wrote about local versus non-local, these two things moved. A variable should only be declared once. So you can reinitialize a variable. You can assign a different value to a variable. Like for instance, you define a variable salary, you assign it 20,000, you print it or you use it in any thing that you want. Then you can say that, oh, I'm finished with that salary. Let's assign 60,000 to that variable. That's totally okay. You are just updating the value into that location. However, it is wrong if you try to redeclare the variable in the same referencing environment. So you cannot do the following: assign 50,000 to the variable, then print it, then redeclare salary as a double and assign 60,000 to it. This is a second declaration in the same block. In Java, you cannot redeclare something once it's already declared. And this is kind of general in any programming language. If you already have a variable declared, like assign the space and somewhere located in memory, you cannot redeclare the variable. You can assign to it a different value, that's fine, but you cannot redeclare the variable. Now, in some programming languages that have dynamic typing, like Python again, there is no difference because the type is inferred. So it doesn't really matter if you assign a value to it because there is no type. This is not an error there. So in Java, it's a compiler error if you try to redefine a variable in the same block. So I wanted actually to show you that. So here we have the main method and we declare double S and then double S. And of course that appears as an error because this is a duplicate local variable already defined. Next. Variables can be used between the point where they were defined in the block and the end of the block in which they were defined. So for instance, you declare a variable, double x is equal to 5. You can now use that variable up to the end of the block because basically anywhere within that block and enclosing blocks, like for instance, if this would be also a block, x is known. So x is known between where it was defined up to the end of the block in which was defined in the entire block, inner blocks and so on. Now, the following example shows a different case. I define a variable y is equal with 100. If y was greater than 0, which it is, I define the variable x equal with 5. I end the block in which x was defined. I have an explicit block here, which is not actually required because anything that is within the if statement is actually an inner block in that if statement. And then I try to print the value of x. This will again appear as a compiler error because x actually disappeared the moment that we finished the if statement. X was defined in the if statement and it disappeared. The moment that you end the block in which that variable was defined, the variable is not available anymore. So let me show you another example. So let's assume that I have an inner block. You can have this kind of inner blocks within other methods. So I can define I is equal with 1. I can print here in the inner block system.out.println I. And this is all fine, but if I try to print it outside the block, like it's still in the main method, but it is outside the block in which I was defined, it will tell me that I is unknown because I was available between the point that it was defined up to the end of the block in which I was defined. So anything afterwards is not available anymore. That's basically it, that you cannot use a variable is available only in the block in which it was defined and anywhere, nowhere else. Now, you don't know if statements yet, but in if statements, the block is optional. So for instance, I can take out, the block is optional as long as internally in the block is a single statement. So if I take out these curly braces, the same problem still holds. X was defined and assigned 5. However, after the if statement is finished, basically we have an end block in implicit. X doesn't exist anymore. So this is still a compiler error because the variable disappeared by the time that we reach that print statement. If you want X to be available outside the block, you can define double X outside the if statement. Okay. So there is a problem with that too. So let me actually show you that. So double Y is equal with 100. Double X if Y is greater than 0, then X is assigned 5, and then we want to print X. So this is still an error, and it tells me that the variable is not initialized. So why do you think that is the case? What do you think is wrong with this main method and how to fix it?
The value for X is given in the if statement. It needs to have a value outside of the if statement.
Exactly. Very good. So the problem is that the if statement is not evaluated. This condition is not evaluated statically. So you would say that this is obvious. 100 is greater than 0, so X will always be initialized with 5. But statements are not evaluated. So when we try to print X here, there are two possible execution paths. One that goes through the if statement, and one for which the if statement was false, and X is actually not initialized. And we said that you cannot use a variable if it hasn't been initialized first. So there is a simple fix to this. You give it a default value outside the if statement. So it doesn't matter if it went through the if or not, still X has a value. Of course, in this case, the value is 5 because Y is still greater than 0. So one thing that you have to consider in all possible cases is that basically, you have to consider all possible execution paths. Even if you know that some execution path will never go through another possible case. That's the way to fix it. Good. So now let's talk about the assignment statement. So usually we assign constants or expressions. So here is the standard way to assign a variable is assigned with equal an expression. What does it do? The order is very important. It first solves, evaluates that expression, then assigns the resulting value to that variable. So for instance, if you have the following statement, integer X is equal with 5, of course, X will be assigned 5. And then X is equal with X plus X plus X plus 10. System out println, X will print what? Great. So basically it uses the old value of X, 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 10. It computes 25, it assigns to X 25, and then it prints X. So basically it does the operation in that order, solves the equation first, then solves the expression first, then it assigns the value to that variable to which it was assigned. Okay. Now, another thing about variables is that they have to be compatible with what the expression that is assigned to that variable. So it's not quite true that the variable and the expression should be the same type. The variable should have a bigger type space-wise than the expression. And that's actually not true either in some cases, because if you assign, so usually real types are considered bigger than integer types. But that's not totally true, because float is represented on 4 bytes and long is 8 bytes. But however, you can still assign a long to a float, because this check is not actually done. The long has 8 bytes. It actually truncates 4 bytes out and assigns the least significant 4 bytes to the float. It's not a compiler error, it's not actually a runtime error. Okay. So let me show you first what do I mean by always the expression must be a subtype of the variable to which is assigned to. So first, basic assignments, we define multiple variables of the type int, sum grades, grade x, grade y. Grade x is assigned 1, sum grades is assigned some number like 1473. Sum grades is assigned the expression 1472 plus 1. So the expression is evaluated first, of course, to the same value, and then is assigned to sum grades. Or sum grades is assigned 1472 plus grade x. Grade x was also an integer, so we have integer plus integer, which is the same value, and that's assigned to sum grades. However, I cannot assign Boolean values. So true cannot be assigned to sum grades. Some languages will allow you to do that, like standard C, but Java basically again makes the strict decision that you cannot mix integers with Booleans. So again, that will be a compiler error. So assignment compatibility means that the variable and the expression should be of compatible types. But usually in Java, what happens is that you can actually, and actually I have that example in the first line. I'm assigning an int to a double. So the int is converted on the fly implicitly to the double. This is an integer represented on 4 bytes, and I can basically fit it in a double. I could have even done something like this. Integer I is assigned with 100, and then double y is equal with I. All good, because smaller types are basically you do a conversion from the type that is representing on a smaller memory location into a bigger memory location. You can basically do the same if you have, let's say, a long, you can assign it to a double. There is no problem there. And similarly, you can basically assign any smaller type to a bigger type. You cannot do it the other way around. So for instance, let's say that I have a long I, which was assigned 100, and then I want to assign y to I to a variable of the type int. And it basically tells you that you cannot do that in Java. If you want to do that, if you want a long to be assigned to an integer and you know that the long is basically an integer, you can actually do an explicit casting. As a programmer, Java lets you basically to say, I know that this, although it's a long, can be casted to an integer, can be stored in an integer location. So the programmer has to write an explicit cast, meaning that only the last 4 bytes will be actually copied into the integer. So it's a programmer decision. The programmer knows that it fits into an integer. So Java has an order of types. Basically, byte is smaller than short, which is smaller than int, which is smaller than long, which is smaller than float, which is smaller than double. Everything is straightforward except this. Long is less than float. It's not quite correct because a long has 8 bytes and the float has 4 bytes. So theoretically, you can take 8 bytes and fit them into a 4 byte location. However, Java made this decision that basically any real number is greater than an integer number. So this is actually possible. You can actually have a variable long defined, and Java lets you assign the value of that variable long to a float. And it will not be an error. Okay, what it basically does, it takes the last 4 bytes of the long and assigns them to the float. But we'll talk more about this a little bit later. So what about mixing numeric types? Basically, there are all of these assignments are okay. You have a variable of the type int x is assigned 5. That's fine. You assign x now to a variable of the type long. You assign now the variable of the type long y to z. These are all fine. However, if you have a double, you can't assign it to a long. Although they both occupy 8 bytes, you can't take integer doubles and assign them to variables of the type integer. Similarly, if you have a long, you can't assign it to an int because basically a long is bigger than an int. You can't take a bigger type and put it in a smaller location. So no assignments of bigger types to smaller types. Also, no assignment to real types, to integer types. However, if you want to assign them, what you can do is cast them. So it basically changes that real type, truncates the digits after decimal point, and basically puts them into the integer type. Okay. So if I have a real 10.0, and it doesn't matter if it's 0 or you have 10.5, you can't directly assign it to an integer value. You have a variable, you have a compiler error. But if you do want to take the real part, the integer part of that real and assign it to an integer, you can cast it to the integer. Basically, you can cast the double to an integer and only keep the integer part. It's really truncation. All the digits after decimal point are erased. Again, there is no mixing of Boolean to integers or reals with any numbers. So basically, you can't cast a Boolean like true or false to integer or any other type, byte or double. Now, let's talk about operators. There are many operators, and there are also auto increments. Prior to the expression to a variable, post a variable. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Let's start with the standard arithmetical operators. Plus is used for addition, minus for subtraction, multiplication or star for multiplication, forward slash for division, percent sign for remainder. We talked about remainder operation of dividing two integers when we did number conversions. So here we have some examples. So also you have to consider the order of operators. So multiplication and division and modulo have higher priority than addition and subtraction. If you want to execute an addition and only then a multiplication, you use parentheses, basically to group together inner expressions before they are used in the outer expression. So here the variables x, y, and z are declared as integers and assigned 5, 10, and 2. Number 1 is assigned the sum of x plus y multiplied with z. So x is 5, y is 10, the sum is 15, and that's multiplied with z, which is 2. So it's basically 30, 15 multiplied with 2. Okay. Any questions? Now, if you eliminate the parentheses, what you get is 5 plus 10 multiplied with 2, which, of course, without the parentheses, it will print 25. because it's 5 plus the result of multiplication. So that's why I basically said that multiplication has higher priority. If you want additions to be executed before, then you will basically have to eliminate, to put parentheses, okay? So in the first expression, we have 25 as the result. My advice is use rules of precedence. That basically, yes, PEMDAS is the rule. Parentheses first, exponents next, multiplication and division next, and addition and subtraction next, okay? One other thing about division. Division is actually different if you divide reals and if you divide integers. So let me actually talk about division. So when you divide integers, like for instance, 1 divided with 2, it will do integer division. You get the quotient of the division. So in our case, 1 divided by 2 is 0 with remainder 1. Okay. So that's when you have integers. If any one of the operands is a real, then the second operand is raised to a real, and the result is going to be a real, 0.5 is real division. So you have integer division when both operands are integers, and you have real division if any of the operands are reals. And by reals, I really mean any double or any float, okay? So either that it, you have 1.0 divided by 2, or you have 1 divided by 2.0, that's also 0.5, or 1.0 divided by 2.0, and that's also 0.5. So you have real division or integer division. Integer division is the quotient of the division if both operands are integers or expressions that evaluate to integers. So in our example here, we have 3 multiplied with 4 plus 5 divided by 6. 5 divided by 6 as an integer is 0. So 3 multiplied with 4 is 12. And that's what this will, that variable will have, 12. In the second example, we have 3 multiplied with 4 plus 5. 4 plus 5 is 9. 3 multiplied with 9 is 27, and we have 27 divided as an integer to 6, it's 3. So integer division is when you divide to integers. A double division, if any of the operands of that division is a real, the second operand will also be raised to a real, and the division will be executed in double. Always when you have an assignment, remember this is an error that beginner programmers always make, is that the expression is evaluated before any assignment takes place. Okay, so when we have this example, double average is equal with 100.0 divided by 8.0, of course average is assigned 12.5. If we assign to average 100.0 divided by 8, it's exactly like in the previous case, is doing double division. So it's also 12.5. However, if we assign to average 100 divided by 8, 100 divided by 8 are both integers, both 100 and 8. So the division is done in integer, which is 12, the quotient. And then when it's assigned to the double variable average, it's cast it from 12 to 12.0. So you see exactly what happens is that the full expression is evaluated and then is doing the assignment. So even if it's assigned to a double, because here we have integer divided by integer, is doing integer division. In the next example, we have 100 divided by 8. It's assigned to an integer, so it's basically 12. If you try to assign a double, division, which the result is a double to some grades, is also, it's an error. Casting has higher priority than division, than any other operation. So basically it first casts 100.0 to 100, but then when it divides with 8.0, it's still double division. So you can't assign it to some grades. If you want to do the division first in real, and then to cast it to an integer, you have to put parentheses around the division, like in the example below. It first does the division, it gets 12.5, then it casts it to an integer, which is 12, and then it assigns to some grades. 50% is equal with 50 divided by 100 is integer division, so you actually get zero. Similarly, if you define the variable 50% as a double, but you assign the result of the integer division 50 divided by 100 is 0.0. Because both of these were integers, the division was executed in integer and is zero as the quotient. And only then is cast to a double when it assigns it to the double variable 50%. And finally, we have 50.0 divided by 100.0, which is actually 0.5. And is assigned to the double variable. The modulo operation, I told you earlier, it basically, it returns the remainder after division. So 100 modulo 8 is basically the remainder is 94, because basically 96 is a multiple of 8, it's 12 multiplied with 8, and you have leftover 4. Now, the next arithmetical operators that probably you don't know are automatic increment by one, automatic decrement by one, increment with a value. So increment with a specified value that appears to the right-hand side. So it's like x plus equal 5 means x is equal with the old value of x plus 5. Similarly for decrement. A variable minus equal an expression, basically decrements that variable with the value of the expression. And you have multiplication equal and division equal. So let me show you first for addition. And there is all, another thing about the first two operators. They can appear as post variable or pre variable. And the meaning is a little bit different. So first we define a bunch of variables. X is equal with 5, Y is equal with 15, and Z is equal with 25. X is assigned X plus 1 is basically X becomes 6. Y is incremented with 1, Y from 15 becomes 16. Z is it's incremented with 1, so Z plus equal 1. Z, which was 25, is 26. So basically, that's the meaning of increment and increment with a specified value. Now, I told you that the plus, plus, and minus, minus, those two increment and decrement operators can appear after the variable or before the variable. And this is important because what basically happens is the following. If the plus, the increment operator appears after the variable, that means that the value of the expression is the old value of I. So basically, after we execute 10 multiply with I, in which case it will be 100, I is incremented with 1. So in this case, new number is 10 multiply with the old value, and then I is incremented. If the plus plus appears before the variable, that's a pre-increment. So basically the meaning of this statement below is that first I is incremented with 1 because this is a pre-increment, and then new number is equal with 10 multiplied with the new value of I. So really the difference is that the value of the expression is, if you have a pre-increment, is the new value of I is incrementing, and then the value of the expression is the new value of I. Or in the case of post-increment, the value of the expression is the old value of I, but I is also post incremented with a value. Before we continue, let me show you a few more examples of this. Okay, so let's define some variable I is equal with 5. And then we have I is incremented with I plus 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 I. What's the value of I after this statement is executed? So let me tell you first what's happening. So first this plus equal is take the old value of I. So in this case is really I is assigned with the old value of I, which was in our case 5 plus. So let's actually just write 5 so we know what we want. I is post incremented. So this, the meaning of that is that now basically we take the old value of I, after which as a side effect, I is incremented with 1. So it's 6. Then we have a plus. So we have plus. I is pre-incremented. So the previous value, so now I is a new value because we already post-incremented it when we evaluated this expression. Every expression first evaluates the sub-expressions, including any side effects that they may have. And then they continue with the next expression. So now I is 6 and pre-incrementing it, it's 7. So basically, first we have the side effect because it's a pre-increment, I becomes 7. And then the value of the expression is 7. So really what we have is that I is now assigned after all of those inner operations ended, the old value of I, which was 5, plus 5, plus 7. So it's basically assigned 17. That's how this is basically executed. So the old value of I is taken by the plus equal. Then the old value of I is first evaluated as the value of that expression, but I is incremented with 1. And then the new value of I after basically we executed the previous steps is taken and pre-incremented with 1. So I becomes 7. And the value of this expression is the new value of I, which is 7. And then we basically execute the expression, which was the old value of I plus 5 plus 7, which is 17. Okay. Now let's play a little bit with this example. What if we have the integer I defined? And like in the previous example, we have pre-increment instead of post-increment and post-increment. So it's I is incremented with plus plus I plus I plus plus. What's the value of I after this is evaluated? So I will execute it while you're thinking. Never do it in your head. Just try to explicitly put it out. So it's the old value of I plus I is pre-incremented. So I is now assigned 6. And now 6 is the value of that expression, this plus plus I. And then we add to it the old value of I and we increment I to 7. However, that has no effect because now basically we compute the value of I based on this new expression, which is 5 plus 6 plus 7, which will evaluate to 18. Basically, that's a new value of I. So let's actually see if this was all correct. So I'm going to copy first the first expression in which I was 17 and put it in Eclipse. And now we print out the value of I. Oops. semicolon, and it prints 17. And then we modify it in the way that we had in that example, plus plus I plus I plus plus. And now it will print 18. Oh, it's still 17. Let me see what happened. So it's I, which was 5, plus pre-increment, which is 6. Plus 6. I mistyped here. It's 6 because I put 6, but I put 7. So it's still 17, but it's computed differently. Very good, Caleb. Actually, not, because 17 was the answer. Okay, good. Scientific notation. So this is something that you asked me last class. Basically, you can use for floating point literals also the exponent, which is basically that we take the base and we multiply it. We take the number and we multiply with the base to the power of that exponent. So we have positive exponents is the same with not actually using the sign. 1.23456E2 means really take this number, multiply it with 10 to the power 2, which is 100. It gives you 123.456. And similarly, e minus 2 is multiplying with 10 to the power minus 2. So it's this number is going to be 0.012345. Now, classes. A program in Java is basically one or more classes in, from which one is public. And that's the name of the file in which this class exists. So basically a program is, you can think of it at right now as a public class. That public class contains a static void main method, a public static void main method, meaning that this main method is main entrance point for your program. The program execution of the program is the beginning of the main method and starts executing step statement by statement. Later, we will also see that the class in Java is also a template or a blueprint for objects. Basically, that you can define a class person with data fields, last name, first name, birth date, and so on. And then you can instantiate objects of that type person. So you can create Paul, or you can create John, or Peter, and so on. Methods is basically a collection of statements to which you give a name, and those statements appear as a sequence. Then when you invoke a method, you call the name of that method with arguments. And these arguments are copied from the parameters that you are sending, the actual arguments, to the parameters of that method. It's similarly, if you think about with a print statement. The print statement is a method that is defined in the object class and in the system output print stream, and basically takes a string and outputs it in the command prompt. So really you have arguments that are passed to the method when you invoke the method. The main method, as I basically said, is the main entrance point to your program. Not all classes are basically required to have a main method, only those that are executable on which you call the JVM. So those must have a main method because otherwise there is no place to start executing the program. It's really like having one set of statements that you execute when you try to do a job. Like for instance, wake up in the morning, make coffee, make omelet, and so on. That's basically the list of methods, the main steps that you basically do when you wake up. And here is an example that we went over a couple of classes ago as an example that we have a Hello World app that is stored in a Hello World app.java file. It may start with a java.comment that explains that explains what this class does. It contains a main method which basically prints out the statement hello world. You can put breakpoints at the beginning of this main method, and you can execute it line by line. Now let's get into a more complex class that you used in the first lab, ChangeMaker. So let's assume that I work in a supermarket and I basically want to return some change at this level only as a number of cents. So which is between 1 and 99 cents. So first thing that I do, I define a set of variables, change, remainder, number of quarters, number of dimes, number of nickels, and number of pennies. I print out a statement with the system.outprint method. I ask the user to input the change amount between 1 and 99 cents. I define a scanner. A scanner is basically an object in Java that is used to read from the input stream, the standard input stream, using methods like next int, next that returns a string, next double, and so on. So it basically allows you to specify what the input will be parsed as. If the input is expected to be an integer, you use the next int method. So input is actually the object that is the scanner dot next int gives you an integer, which you are going to assign now to the change variable. So the number of quarters is assigned the change divided by 25. This is integer division, int by int, and it basically returns you the quotient of that division. So if the number, let's say, was 78, it will tell you you need 3 quarters. 78 divided by 25 in integer, it gives you the quotient 3, and that's the number of quarters. Then you use the modulo operator, the remainder operator, to return what's left after division with 25. And it tells you there are 3 cents left. That's the change. Now you continue. How many dimes can I use to pay this remaining reminder divided by 10? If you have 3 cents left, it will tell you not 0 dimes. And it continues. Now the reminder is the reminder modulo 10, which is still 3 in our example of 78. And then how many nickels I can use? Again, you divide the reminder by 5. It gives you how many nickels you use, which in the case of 78 is 0. Then the reminder is the old reminder modulo 5. Now the number of pennies is just assigned this reminder. So now we can print. In order to pay that amount, you need this number of quarters. So the quarters concatenated with the string quarters, the dimes concatenated with the string dimes, the nickels concatenated with the nickels, and the pennies. Okay, that sounds very interesting. I can basically respond to that question. That's an interesting idea how to make the change by converting from base 10 to base 2. We can actually look over it after the class. Okay, now let's actually run this program and modify it a bit. So we don't need to actually, let's create a change program. And I can basically just take all of this code. Okay. So as I had in that example, if I basically now want to run it, I need to import scanner. Okay, and I can run it. And let's try with our example of 78 cents. And it tells me that I need 3 quarters, 0 dimes, 0 nickels, and 3 pennies. You can modify a little bit the program. So one thing that one could do is if some number of coins is not needed, you can basically filter it out. So you can do if, let's say, the number of quarters is different than 0. I will show you how to do this next class. basically you print the number of quarters. Otherwise, you don't. And similarly, if the number of dimes is different than zero, then you will print the number of dimes. If the number of nickels is different than zero, then you print the number of nickels. And if the number of pennies is different than zero, then you print the number of pennies. And let's put a comma here. So now the same program is modified a bit. If I enter 78, it will tell me that I need 3/4 and 3 pennies. It doesn't mention anymore the dimes and the nickels. I can also modify it a little bit more. So let's assume that I have an integer amount and this is in dollars, okay? So I will modify a little bit more this program. In fact, let me take these variables and do them later. So let's ask the user what's the price. And this is price in dollars with cents following. So price in dollars, for example, $13.45. So now we'll ask the user to enter. We need a double to store that. So let's use a value amount. And we need to use next double. Then we can, let me just move this one line below. Now we can ask the user from what amount. Let's say that the user gives $20, okay, a bill. So price, that was the original price. Let's put it here. Price from what? Like for instance, from $20, okay? You don't need to use integers. You can still use double from, and now you can use double. Rest is from minus the price. Usually modulo operations work for integers. So what I would do next, maybe actually a little bit controversial, I would change everything in cents. So basically I would assign the rest multiplied with 100, and then I would convert it all in cents. That basically will give me easier way to actually return the everything, dollars, bills, and cents in the same way, okay? So let's actually do it. So we need the number of $20 bills. 20, okay. So for the 20s, I need the cents and divide it by 2000. Basically, $20 by 100 cents per dollar is 2000. So this actually gives me how many bills I need for 20s. And then I can define remainder, and it's those cents modulo 2000. Okay, now I continue this operation. I see that it's 722, so I will actually try to finish this program. You are welcome to watch it afterwards, okay? But I will basically do it to completion. So the number of $10 bills is basically whatever is left, this remainder divided by 1000, and the remainder itself is the remainder modulo 1000. Again, if you need to leave, you can watch the recording later. Now we need the number of $5 bills. And for that, we divide by 500. And we take the remainder after 500. Then we need the number of $1 bills. And that will be the remainder after division with 100. And then I can basically use the rest of the code, but replace change in the first two lines with remainder. And now we can also add code to print the number of dollar bills. So 20s is different than zero, then the print the number of 20s. $20 bills. And similar for tens. $10 bills, fives. $5 bills, ones. And I'm gonna print the $1 bills. Probably it's not a bad idea also at the beginning to print what is the rest. So I'm gonna print it right here. So let's call it return. And is this rest? So let's try it. So let's say that I actually have to print return 13.45 out of a $20 bill. Oops. Okay, it's fine. Basically, the rest is printed with multiple digits. You see, now you can see why subtracting what data number doesn't give you exact value. So what I will do, I will use a printf statement and I will say I want to print a float with two digits after the decimal point. Decimal with two digits after the decimal point. Let's run it again and make sure that this runs. Actually, also print a new line afterwards. I will explain to you what that is. So 13.45 out of $20. Oops, the formatter didn't work properly. Okay. Let's see. Float. Okay. 13.45 out of $20 bill. Okay, didn't print quite what I wanted. Percent F. Percent 2F, the order was wrong. 13.45 out of $20. I have to return $6.55. And for that, I need a $5 bill, a $1 bill, two quarters and two nickels and one nickel. Okay, that's it. Good. So that's basically what I wanted, and I will cover the rest next class. Any questions before we finish the class? I saw there are 5 questions in the chat. Do we have to use the int rest, double rest? Oh, wait, never mind. Maybe ID. Okay, I guess you understood the code and you can actually play with it. So I basically read doubles, but once I finished the reading as doubles, I converted everything to cents, and then I did all conversions to int in integers, which actually saved us a lot, because we didn't have this operator is defined for integers. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much. See you in the lab in 20 minutes.